Hello. Welcome to another edition of the Mike Zielinski Show. I'm Mike Zielinski. I'm privileged to have as my guest today, Ara, who is a singer, a songwriter, and an actress. And welcome.
Thank you.
You really have some unique sounds, a very unique story. We got a lot to cover here, so why don't we just jump in? And you just don't write songs. You create like sound experiences. It's a combination of melody, sounds. I know your latest project has layers of trance, which is layered atmospheric electronic music. You have a background in audio and video, and you're working, and you have a record contract for Voice of an Angel, and you work with a producer and a DJ from Switzerland whom you've never met.
Yes.
And he does not speak English, you do not speak French, but it worked, and you're selling this track internationally. So tell us about a little bit about your music, and then we'll talk a little bit about Voice of an Angel.
Sure. The music, I guess the kind of fascination with all the electronic sounds started for me really, really young. I always had an obsession with synthesizers and low frequency oscillation and the sounds that you could kind of create with that. So I always had this weird kind of thing with the synth. So then that led into wanting to make music with it and see what I could do with it. And a couple of groups that really influenced me when I was young is Enigma and Dead Can Dance. And the difference with them from, like, you know, the standard stuff that was on the radio, which was also a huge influence, Madonna and whatnot, was the fact that, like, it always felt like they took you somewhere, maybe a different place in time, or it just was like all-encompassing. It wasn't just something you hum along to. It was kind of like, wow, I'm there. So that was the inspiration to kind of start something a little different, a little more atmospheric, and a little more, I guess, complex. Not complex, I wouldn't say, oh, what's the word? Just, I guess, a little more, it was referred to sometimes cinematic, I guess.
You know, it's kind of like whether it's on one of your recordings and you're working on your third CD.
Yeah.
Or your live performances, you're all about creating magic, correct?
Yes.
And uplifting people's spirits and transporting them from the mundaneness of everyday life. And maybe it's almost like listening to your music is kind of like a total immersion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So let's talk about Voice of an Angel. You know, let's talk about Steve Sanders, the gentleman you're working with. How did this work, you know?
Well, he by chance found my website, it was probably 2 years ago. And he said, would you be interested in doing some vocal tracks for my trance tracks? Now, I'm really passionate about trance music, so it was like a dream come true for me. And I loved his style and the way he builds things.
And you had heard of him?
I hadn't.
Okay.
I actually hadn't. And the one label he worked for, Black Hole Records, is actually the biggest trance label in all the world. It's actually, was started by DJ Tiesto, and he was one of the pioneers in the genre.
Is this genre pretty popular in America?
Actually, now they refer to it, like here it's EDM, and it's getting huge now, but it's been popular in Europe for probably 20 years.
And you sell records in Europe with your CDs and stuff.
Yes.
You're probably bigger in Europe than you are in the States. Is that fair to say?
Or it would be a toss-up.
Okay. Well,
yeah.
Great to have both. So I'm sorry. Get back to so Voice of an Angel and Steve Sanders. So how did you guys interact? You know, you're here in the States and he's over there in Switzerland.
Yeah. He would create tracks and he'd forward them to me in Dropbox and I'd put them into Logic, which is the software that I compose on, and I'd lay it in and lay down vocal ideas and then send them back. And we just kept, you know, back and forth until we came up with something we're really happy with. It was probably a year.
Now, I know he doesn't speak English, but when you email him and stuff like that, it would be in English. Do you at least understand that a little
it
bit?
It goes between, vice versa? Well, I studied French for 9 years, so.
Oh, you do? Okay.
We do
all
a
right.
kind of.
We would do, was a story, not just kidding.
We would do kind of call it like Fringlish.
Okay,
like
I
would
so you have a work, you can get by. You could order dinner in Paris if you had to, right?
Sure. Yeah. And okay. He has some English, I have some French, so we kind of just go back and forth in between somewhere, you know, and figure it out. But yeah, kind of the music speaks its own thing, so, you know.
And then he got you guys a, you're with a record contract.
Yeah,
and it's
yeah.
Pure Decibel. I kind of thought that was an interesting name for a trance song. You know, I would think maybe heavy metal would be in Pure Decibel.
Yeah, for a trance label. Yeah, yeah, it's actually based out of Thailand, but it's international. They distribute all over the world.
And how's the sales going so far?
Great, great.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah.
I've heard it. I want our audience to hear it, so could you cue it up?
Sure.
She's a technical expert here, so with electronic music, so we're not going to have any glitches here, right?
No.
All right. Wow, that is something, it does transport you. It kind of puts you in a different realm. Mm-hmm. And it's a great, like if you're stressed, that de-stresses you, I would think, you know?
Absolutely,
That's wonderful work.
Yeah.
Now let's talk a little bit about your two albums. Mm-hmm. They're Mystic and Temple Beautiful. Mm-hmm. And as you refer to them as cinematic electro pop. Mm-hmm. And so, and they're selling, in Europe and the Middle East and here in the States. Mm-hmm. So how are they trance music per se? And we're going to hear one of the tracks. Are they somewhat similar? Or?
They have varied influences. I'd say they're a little more organic with, I don't know, because like in the one song I have a dobro and different, I don't really exactly know what to call it. It does have definitely a lot of electronic influences. But I would say it's just a little bit more full of like orchestral songs, sounds.
When you create music, you like to just see where it goes. It's mm-hmm. kind of exciting.
Yeah.
That's why you don't like to confine yourself to a particular genre. You are very genre melding.
Yeah.
And that's what gives you the creative inspiration to keep doing this.
I mean, whenever I try to focus the tracks into something, it's not going to happen.
Yeah.
They just kind of like, no, we're going over here and you have to deal with it. So yeah, they kind of like a mind of like a personality of their own, you know?
Now, obviously it can be an artistic masterpiece, but is it a little hard commercially to mm-hmm. get airtime sometimes if you don't fit a certain format?
Absolutely. Yeah, that's why I'd say the second CD is a little bit more kind of, has a more verse-chorus structure. The first one was kind of like, you know, but, you know, you find your people that really appreciate that difference, and they're like your people, you know. And
yeah.
it's interesting, you know. I think people are kind of yearning for some new sounds and ways of you know, a song style type.
Is your third album going to be similar to the first two, or be more trance influenced?
I think the third might be a little more commercially viable.
Mm-hmm.
It's a direction I have never really focused.
And why is that? You just want to try it?
Yeah, I want to try it.
Now, will you have to be a little bit more restrictive in your creative space to do so?
Yeah, I'll have to.
What kind of genre will it be? It's not going to be country western, right?
No. I think it'll probably be something along the lines EDM, electronic dance music.
Okay.
Trance influence, definitely. Maybe a little more pop, you know, maybe just a little more palatable.
Now, the demographic of the people who really get into your music,
mm-hmm.
Trend younger, I would assume?
It's all over the board.
Really?
It's a huge variety. We have, like...
So people like me who have just passed their 35th birthday, they're into trance and stuff like
Absolutely,
that?
Absolutely, yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
All right, you know, we have a... one of the tracks from Temple Beautiful, mm-hmm. In Your Dreams, which is interesting because I guess when you write, a lot of it comes from, like you say, you cover love, loss, spirituality, soulmates,
mm-hmm.
transcending negative or mundane circumstances to find magic, that theme again.
Mm-hmm.
How does this song fit into that?
This fits into that in the respect of, it's kind of about the potential. Do you know what things could be if you would just... you know, try to live in the dream, you know, try to make it real. And it's also about, you know, the second verse talks about how much I've lost by doubting. And you know, it's not easy to try to, it's not easy, well, nothing in the arts is, but you get a lot of kind of like, kind of just, I don't guess, you know, why don't you go work over here, or, you know, it's not so, I believed a lot throughout my life, you know, I really, it's been a struggle the whole way through.
But you earn a living doing this?
Yes.
Selling your records, mm-hmm. and performances, which we'll get to.
Yeah.
Which is awesome, so that gives you a little bit of that artistic freedom.
Absolutely.
So would you please
sure.
Cue up In Your Dreams? I'd love to hear it, and I'm sure our audience would as well. I want to talk about your acting, but first, tell us a little bit about your live performances. I mean, you have lived in Istanbul, part easy for me to say, L.A., you're back here, but not permanently. You are from Berks County.
Yes.
And you may be moving back to L.A. or maybe Miami.
Mm-hmm.
And you perform all kinds of places. And locally, it's been a Berks County's treat to have you at a lot of places, including you're at the Crown Plaza every Wednesday night, and I know you have a big following.
Mm-hmm.
Your live performances are just a little bit different from your recording to a degree, right?
Yeah, the live shows.
The parties.
Yeah, they are. They really, like my friend refers to it as a party in a box. Like, there's a lot of covers. The covers are from all over. I mean, a huge variety of covers.
But you 80s, do originals too,
now.
Right?
Yeah, a few originals.
Do you have a group or is everything electronic and you're singing live?
It's me, a MIDI controller, keyboard,
okay,
and my laptop, basically, and the Bose system.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And you're having fun with that, and you love the interaction with audiences.
Oh my gosh, yeah. The greatest
All right.
thing.
Well, if you don't have enough on your plate, you've also made your acting debut, and I know you acted at Governor Mifflin and at Kutztown University.
Mm-hmm.
This movie is called From the End into the Beginning. It was shot in a cabin in Olley Valley in 2014.
Mm-hmm.
Your co-star was Keegan Moyer, whose father is an iconic soccer figure in Berks County, Mike Moyer. Tell us a little bit about this movie and whether you're going to continue acting or not.
It wasn't part of the plan, but I enjoyed it, and it may be a path that I take in the future. I loved becoming the character. It's about a woman. She's actually the writer of the movie is from the area as well, Paige Suzanne, and it's her life story. It's her and her husband's life story. Their
and it
love.
Spans a number of years, right?
Absolutely, so, 25 years.
So they aged you and Keegan as it went on with
Actually,
makeup?
We were the young versions.
Oh, okay.
Of,
and then
had
their actors to the older version.
We were them the whole time.
Okay.
They were kind of...
Oh, they didn't show physically. I get it.
Yeah, until the very end.
Okay.
Until the very end, they do. They show. They get in the car, and it's kind of very symbolic. But it's basically their love story, but these kind of unbelievable hurdles that they've had to endure. And so it's kind of a story like about triumph over adversity kind of thing, and a love story as well.
What's the parallels between acting and performing on stage?
I think it's actually very similar, because when you're singing a great like upbeat song, you're in that mode. When you're singing something down or something that's touching, you're in that mode too. So it's the same in the respect that you become that. You become this other, whatever it is that you are that day, or the person, or the song. You become, you almost become a vessel for this instead of yourself.
Now, I know the debut, the premiere of this movie was in Berks County, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And where was that?
That was at the Miller Arts Center.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And
at RAC.
Where was it distributed elsewhere?
Right now, there's a lot going on. I can't mention some of it but the one thing is it's basically going to be going into independent film festivals and whatnot.
Oh, so that'd be great. And that can lead to a wider audience.
Absolutely, yeah.
So is it, I guess you're ambivalent about your acting just because you're so busy with your musical career, or if the right opportunity, are you seeking another opportunity, or just if it comes your way?
I guess right now I want to focus on the next CD. Acting is actually something I would definitely consider. I'm just kind of, there's a few things with music that I need to do immediately that I'm really focused on, especially that Steve sent another progression. So
you're working on another single. And then I was remiss because I know you guys have plans to do more and maybe do a CD together eventually.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
Oh, that's exciting. So besides acting in films, you have written music for movies, right?
Actually, that's the first movie.
You did the soundtracks for that?
Yeah. The whole soundtrack is all, it was interesting because she said, do you have some music? She's actually comes out to shows. We're very, really close friends. And, she said, do you have any music? And at the time, it so happened that I had these couple tracks that were just started, but they were just fit so well. So kind of just worked from there.
So did you read the script, obviously, especially since you were acting in it, and then you kind of based your soundtrack on the script?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
And we are privileged to have a track from that, right? And it's called Now and Then. So please cue that up. So great to have a pro here. You don't want me doing this. You know? You'd be singing. What can I say? You know, it's, I don't think I'm at BCTV right now. It kind of like takes you to a different spiritual existence. But anyway, wonderful.
Thank you.
I want to talk about, you live in Istanbul two different times, 2002 to 2003 and from 2009 to 2011.
Mm-hmm.
You work for a media company there and you speak fluent Turkish. I mean,
Evet.
Evet. And how does that happen? You know, and so tell us, you know, when I think of Istanbul, I think of like kind of eerie, dangerous, sensual, don't get busted with drugs, you know.
Turkish prison, yeah.
Yeah, Turkish prison, you know. Tell us about it a little bit. Yeah.
It's absolutely like, it's enchanting. I mean, it did. It put a spell on me. I mean, it was like living in almost like an enchanted fairyland between fairy tale land.
Yeah.
I mean, no, you have all those elements at the same time, but that's what kind of like is the kind of the attraction. It's completely East meets West. It's the most, I think, the most liberal Islamic country. So it's not, you know, when you go places, it's kind of reminds me on certain levels of certain places in Italy, you know, like people dress. But the thing that struck me the most was like the heart of the people. I mean, everybody's brother, sister, I was abla, to like complete strangers. And like the family that I stayed with treated me like family. And amazing, like the food, out of this world, the music, the sights, you know, the Bosphorus in the middle of summer with this music and these ancient Roman ruins mixed in with mosques and oh my gosh, it's just enchanting. It's enchanting.
And
it's beautiful.
Did that have an impact on your musical career?
Absolutely, yeah.
Wow. What an experience. Real quickly, did you learn to speak Turkish before you went there or while you were there?
I started to study it before I went, but really the whole immersion was the thing, just hearing it continuously. I mean, there was probably 6 months where I didn't speak English at all.
All right.
And that's when you really get to know yourself.
Yeah, I can imagine. We just have a couple minutes left. Thank you. You've been awesome.
Thank you so much. Tell us a little bit
about your upcoming performances and where people can find your website and Facebook.
Sure. Well, like you said, I'm at the Crown Plaza every Wednesday. I have another appearance on WFMZ next Saturday for Saturday Sunrise, and that's going to be a live performance on air.
During their new show, which is interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And what else do I have? I have some private stuff coming up. I'll be at Galen Hall the first Saturday in May over at the golf club. So...
It's a really nice place over there.
It's great. Apparently the water has magical properties, so bring your junk
along. I didn't know that.
Yeah, they said it's like really
intense. One minute left. Where can people find you online and also on your Facebook page?
You can find me at www.arasound.com, all one word, Arasound. And then I'm on Facebook. I have a fan page under Ara, and my personal page is Ara Germain. That's my middle name, so...
So one name professionally, just like Cher, Bono, Elvis. Yeah. Maybe there's a trend here. All right. Well, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. It was
so
a pleasure meeting you.
Good luck.
Best of luck in your global endeavors. And for now, this is Mike Zielinski saying until next time, take care.